All right, welcome back. We're going to be talking about, you know, adapting life now to the new norm of working from home, which a lot of people have been practicing for the last month plus, especially in states where the lockdown was imposed. A lot of people have been working from home, and it's something that a lot of Nigerians probably didn't think was possible because most companies never really encouraged it. The Nigerian mentality is we need to see you at work to know that you're working. But with the new changes, I want to talk about, you know, going forward, is this going to be the new norm or is it just a phase with the lockdown and the virus while we have it? I have been joined now by Jane Egerton-Idehia, who is a tech communication executive. How are you doing, Jane?
Hi, I'm doing well. Hi, Booker.
Thanks a lot for joining me. Now, of course, like I said, we live in a country where working from home seemed such an alien idea. Most companies always or offices wanted to see you to know that you were working. What's even with meetings? Things as simple as meetings. I mean, we complain a lot about traffic in Lagos, for example, and you find that most half the time people are going to meetings that last an hour or with things that could have been done over the phone. All of a sudden, these things look like they're possible with all of these apps and, you know, things that that we have these days. Do you think this is a new norm or is this a phase that we're just going to go through?
Well, if I want to look at it from the trend of what we see, I think it's going to be partly the new normal, not entirely. It will be difficult for some businesses to adapt, but I think on the average, we will somehow be influenced in one way or the other. It could be forcing some of our meetings to go online, especially if they don't require that physical presence. Or it could actually just change the way we do business. We will then have flexible working hours. We might not require that everybody be at the office all the time at the same time. So I think it will influence it. I don't think we're going to go exactly to how it was. It would influence it in some way.
If we're going to be very honest, but there are a lot of people who believing that, you know, you need to come to the office is not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, if we're going to think about some of the most technologically advanced countries in the world, Japan definitely comes to mind. But that's the one country that has found it hard to completely shut down its country because they have a culture of people coming to work. And they've found it very hard to let people work from home. And you think of Japan, you think that that's very absurd. So there's a reason why people like to see you at work. Do you think working from home is effective, if you're being honest? Because I've seen people complaining on social media in the last couple of weeks saying, half the time I'm trying to work, my daughter runs across and tries to, you know, get my attention, or there's something on TV that catches my attention and I forget I'm supposed to be working, you know. Has it really been proven to be effective?
So, you know, some study shows that it's not really effective. So I think some studies done in China, some business in China, really effective for most people to work from home. So in terms of that, you know, it might not be entirely effective if you look at the way we do business. But you have to consider that there are reasons why, isn't it? Like you said, it could be cultural. You know, if the cultural context is that we like to see each other, just like the Japanese culture. If I want to discuss business with you, until my banker shows up, I don't take them serious. They can say, when I see in the office, I know now you're talking business. You know, there are some deals you want to close, no matter the amount of Zoom calls you do and emails you send, until you show up physically, people then take you, okay, I can put a face to that name, and now I can see you and I can put you in that, I can see your business in perspective, then I can take you serious. But I think what this thing has done is just shocked the system to force us to look at other ways. So I don't think entirely we're going to change because there's a huge cultural undertone. We as Africans or Nigerians are very social, you know. You want to greet people, even just some of our smaller habits that are not very effective in the workplace, like Nigerian time. So if I book a meeting with you at 1 o'clock, it's almost normal if you show up at 1:30, you know, especially depends on where the power ranking is coming from. But you can't do that on Zoom. If you show up at 1:30 or 1:40, the Zoom session is already over. You know, you have to stick to the time. But these, because of our cultural context, we accommodate those with discrepancy. You understand? You could wait for the person for 1 hour or 2 hours. But when you use the online tools, it doesn't adapt in that manner. But we can now see that there'll be value in using the online tools or online ways of working in other parts, which we have struggled to. I think kudos to the women. For a long time, you know, it's been a big issue to get women to accommodate women to do some kind of online work or flexible work, some in some phase of their career, you know, when they're having kids, in that child-rearing phase, because most times it's difficult if you breastfed a kid the whole night to show up for work at 8. Probably you just went to bed at 5 a.m. To show up at work at 8 means you have to wake up at 6, get ready, and be for that meeting at 8. It's very difficult. It's difficult during the first 2 years when you're doing 9 immunization sessions, and they're normally doing a working day. You know, those kind of scenarios were tougher to ask your boss that, oh, I want to work from home. But I think now that we've all experienced it, I don't think it's going to be a bad thing next time you pull up and tell your boss, oh, my son has an immunization for half the day. I would like to work from home during the early hours of the day so that I can accommodate the missing hours. So I think we would tend to start to accept some of these new norms. We're not entirely going to change. Change is always gradual. It's difficult for human beings to, you know, get like a, just get a huge shock in the system. But I think we will start to accept some of these new norms.
Very, very, very interesting point you made there. But let's leave the working from home for a bit now and, you know, go to our actual work. Because, I mean, it was Workers' Day on Friday, even though there were hardly any people at work on the day. But most people in most states across the nation are going to be going back to work, even if it's for a limited time from tomorrow, we hear. What sorts of, you know, behaviors, what sort of culture do you want to see at the offices now, especially considering the fact that this virus has not even peaked in Nigeria yet? I mean, we're still climbing with regards to the numbers we're seeing. What do you want to see offices implement? And what you've seen with the way Nigerians work in the offices, do you think it's possible for our offices to be safe enough in these times?
I don't think we have an option, Ibuka. Do we have an option? I think we have to really make it a priority. So definitely the whole PPE, hand sanitizers, facial masks, we have to do that. It's really important. But I think the case, where I see offices will struggle, because these are the easier part, is the social distancing. You think about some offices, the way the layout is an open layout. How do you stimulate social distancing in that kind of layout? If you have this open office where everybody just, you know, it's an open floor, we're all next to each other, then I think for offices, one of the things I would like to see, which I know will be a struggle, is also what do you do with the meeting points? So offices have to think about that. You know, we all meet at lunch in a canteen and the proximity is so close, you know. So we have to start, you know, changing the way we work. What I see is that offices will also have to consider what happens, you know, in cases like where we have that kind of open layout. How do you minimize physical presence? So it could mean things like people would have to show up to work at different times, so they'll clock in differently. I know my company was thinking about flexible working hours. So it means maybe in a team, some people come Monday, Wednesday, Friday for a start, and the others will come Tuesdays and Thursdays, just to reduce the presence, physical presence at the same time in that unit, if the layout is not good for it. So I think we have to start being creative. We can't say, oh, we can't do anything. I think it's forcing us to innovate, you know, apart from the standard, you know, let's keep those safety measures physically. We have to start thinking about the strategy to implement social distancing. So it might require that maybe most companies might not be able to go to work immediately on Monday. And I think that would happen a lot for the multinationals because the risk is higher for them. They will probably have more staff. They have to really think through, how do you implement social distancing? So things like the office layout, people, staff presence at the same time. Even mothers, what do you do with the working mothers? You know, you have to think about that. Now you go to work, the schools are not open. What's going to happen to the kids? If you do have working mothers as staff and they do have kids, I think that's going to be another challenge. Are they going to leave their kids at home and show up to work? Maybe they'll be reluctant. Maybe they'll be willing to consider flexible working hours. The possibilities are endless, but we have to force ourselves to innovate. I think that's it.
That's very key, because, I mean, you mentioned it there. I was speaking with my brother yesterday and he said the same thing. I think his office is trying to shuffle days as well, I think. You come every other day or something along those lines. Those are very brilliant ways to work around it. But since talking about jobs, I mean, there was a bank executive who went viral a couple of days ago talking about the fact that, you know, jobs will have to be cut. I think he said something almost 70% of the staff strength of his organization might have to go, because not only has can they not afford to pay a lot of people anymore because, you know, revenue has been hit seriously. This pandemic or the lockdown has let people sort of see that, okay, there are some things that are not required or some jobs that can actually be done away with, which has been the fear for a lot of people, you know, the increment in unemployment. But there are a lot of jobs that people are afraid that they may never get back. You know, what sort of jobs do you see that have been threatened, you know, in a time like this, with especially technology coming to take the spaces?
So I think that's one of the impacts of the future of work is that, you know, things that especially tasks that can be that routine based, that can be automated, we might see those job roles dropping off. We will probably be looking for more, you know, the higher level tasks that we cannot automate that are not routine based. So that's one. But I think another impact will be the fact that some companies will go through financial strain. It's just natural. A company that really has a very tight cash flow and doesn't have the right capital outlay, if you stayed without clients or revenue for like 6 weeks, most of them cannot keep up. They probably have, you know, they have raised huge debts and they cannot pay them off because they have not generated any revenue in that time. So you see like what is happening to the airline sector. You see airlines actually laying off people. So the sad truth is that there might be some layoffs. So one is the future of work, the impact of the whole online tools. The second one is the fact that businesses that cannot keep up and they needed to keep up will be forced to reduce the headcount to survive. So that would also be another, that would be another huge impact that would affect. They might need the staff, it's just that they need to survive. And one of the only ways to survive is to reduce your cost. And you look for where you look for the aspects of your business that give you the highest cost and you start shedding that load. So people will be affected from that angle as well.
I don't know if this is completely your purview or not your purview, but I want to talk insurance now. How much of a role will insurance play in all of this? Because there are people who are saying, oh, maybe some of this, I mean, I know that I've heard, I think in the UK, some companies were actually had been paying a pandemic insurance. I don't know if we had that ever in Nigeria. So I don't know if you had to be paying that to be covered in certain ways, because, I mean, everybody's looking for a way to sort of ease things up. What role do you see insurance companies playing in all of this?
Well, it's possible they would have, but to the extent at which they're insured, that's another thing. So they probably would not have perceived a huge risk as this, and they would have limited that insurance they went for. But for most of us, I think the big multinationals would have, because they are always, you know, constraining things. It's actually, for some of them, it's even part of the requirements to list on the stock exchange and all that. You have to make some kind of, you have to insure yourself for some kind of uncertainties. But smaller and medium-sized businesses that have really not envisaged this or do not have the capacity to insure to that extent would not have done anything. But I think this is a good role for insurance as well, like you were just mentioning. I think we should start considering this kind of insurance. You know, how can you insure your business to prevent a future pandemic like this affecting you? There's some things you can never really insure. You know, like one of the things that happened of recent, just at the early part of the pandemic, one of the big startups in my sector actually collapsed because they couldn't raise the amount of venture funding they were trying to raise. Because at that time, it wasn't a priority to give them a loan. We had already existing businesses that were looking for funds. So private investors or investors would rather fund those businesses than you, the new startup or the new venture. So that kind of case, you can never insure it. You're actually trying to, you know, pull yourself up as a business. But for existing businesses, I think this is another new outlay for insurance company to consider, how do you put some kind of measures and insure your business, you know, against some kind of pandemic that will come in the future or crisis, whatever we choose to call it. How do you ensure that you can keep your operation running? It doesn't mean that you entirely save the entire operation, but at least you can keep your core operation running. So insurance companies, it's up to you, you know, new products to be
exactly to markets to us. But looking at the way things have turned out now, very short question. Are you worried for unemployment in Nigeria? Are you worried for the job sector, jobs market?
Frank, some days I wake up, I'm sad. I would like to say I'm not worried. I'm naturally optimistic, you know. I'm naturally looking at the glass half full. But some days I wake up worried because I know the impact on companies. I know the impact on revenue. Even the sectors we think that are making money, you know, initially there was a boom in data. So sectors like the telecom were very happy because people were online making data calls, trying most of the activities, even to church, you know, was online. But we saw that the longer the pandemic took, it kind of flattened and it's going down a bit. Because now people have now realized, oh, we don't have that kind of disposable income. We need to save. Because in this kind of scenarios, people now start thinking of saving, reducing costs. So they don't want to give up that money for airtime or buying data anymore. They really want to find a way to reduce their spending and save more. So even those sectors are saying that, okay, this is not going to be Christmas forever. Now things are changing. Yeah. So what will come to do? They start to reduce costs. And where do they go to? Headcount. That's the easiest way. Headcount. So you see, it's going to be one of those cases where, you know, we'll come out of this, those of them that still have work, or those of us that still have a job, if I do, you know, those of us that will have a job, we have probably been doing community, you have to help the community around. But I also think it's time for us, because I love to see the glass always half full. It's time for people to start looking at the future of work and looking, how do I upskill myself that I have skill set that I can work with a new trend? You know, if you've someone does, because it's really what is happening. You know, I was discussing earlier on with a friend. She teaches at one of these, Ivy League schools, universities in the U.S. And she said some of the lecturers didn't even know how to use Zoom. Professors were so used to walking into a class and giving a lecture, they didn't want to use online tools. Now they were being forced to do Zoom classes. So I would say for people that had traditionally thought that this was not all about them, they're not a millennial, they don't like this online thing, this is the time to embrace it if you can. You know, start with baby steps, you know, how to use your basic tools, because that is becoming the future of work. We will find out that skill sets will change. So you have to go up the ladder where you have to use your cognitive abilities rather than routine tasks. You know, those basic routine tasks that we can automate, we would automate them and take them off. So if I look at it, the glass half full, I'll say, if I'm somebody sitting out there, instead of worrying, I think it's time to review, reflect, and ask yourself the real questions. Are your skill sets portable? Are they in line with what we see in the trend? If they're not, how can you bridge that gap? How can you have those skill sets that you can either port or they're in tune with the future of work?
Thank you very much, Jane Egasinidehe. Very good way to wrap up the conversation today. Thanks for the insights. And please stay safe and stay at home if you don't have to be out tomorrow. Thank you very much for joining us. We'll take another break and be right back. Please don't go away.